คสวัสดีครับตอนนี้เพิ่งซ้อม อกกับมิสเตอร์เจอร์มี่เสร็จเรียบร้อยนะครับเดี๋ยวเรามาอินเทอร์วิวสัมภาษณ์กับเจอร์มี่นิดหน่อยนะครับให้กับท่านผู้ชมทาง channel ฟังนะครับโอเคไกด์ so we just finished like very heavy training I tear a little bit my peg a little bit but also we get some question from the follower in Thailand so before like we get to the question I get from your fan club back in Thailand can you just give a short introduction for yourself for the follower
yeah you guys I'm Jeremy Buendia you're three-time men's physique Olympia champion I've been training for over 12 years in bodybuilding now something I fell in love with from a very young age and something that grew into a passion and I decided to make a job out of it something I love and something I can do every single day and never get sick of and I've been able to do that and it's just been a lot of hard consistent work and figuring out a way to make a living doing exactly what I love doing for fun and it's been amazing
all right cool thank you Jeremy the three question I gather from the fan club the Jeremy Bonner fan club back in Thailand so they really want to know this question so the first question is how do you really develop your big thick and why chest
that's usually the one of the top questions that comes up and everywhere I am I've taken a lot of pride in my chest training from a young age growing up my dad wasn't really into bench pressing we always had the setup in the gym my dad was a big bench presser growing up 155 pounds throwing up 440 on a bench press at 50 years old yeah. He was always strong and bench press was like one of the big things that growing up with me and something that my dad always did so I started benching at a young age and that was the lift that I always strived to really focus on so I had a good foundation and grew a pretty thick chest early on but as I began bodybuilding I realized that it's also a very good way of getting injured it's not a very natural position for your shoulders to be in when you're bench pressing so I did end up hurting my chest when I was 19 years old bench pressing a lot of weight. I hit around 200 kilos at 19. And
219?
At 19 years old, I hit about 200 kilos. Maybe a little bit more because it was 450, 455. When I did that, I tweaked my shoulder a little bit and that led to some, slight tears in my chest. And my chest was really never the same after that. So I really haven't done much bench pressing since. Yeah. And besides, a lot of dumbbell work is a lot better for optimizing growth and hypertrophy and bodybuilding. Mm-hmm. You're able to get a lot more tension on it. You're able to get a deeper stretch and more range of motion. And that's one of the things that you want to focus on when developing your chest is, making sure that your body placement's correct, that you're actually activating and stretching the muscle fibers. And that's going to cause a three-dimensional muscle by developing a pump, and stretching and maximizing those fibers as much as possible. Yeah. I utilize the FST7 training principles. I use a lot of partial reps, a lot of static holds, a lot of stuff to volumize the chest when I'm training. And that's what we got to focus on in every muscle group. But primarily chest, that's the one muscle group that you really want to develop because that's what's going to cause the depth to your physique. Mm-hmm. So I utilize a lot of my refeed days on my chest training day. So I make sure I over-nourish that muscle. I take in more calories, more red meats, more sodium, just to make sure I'm volumizing that muscle as much as possible. I'm going to get as much growth as I can when I'm tearing down the muscle. So those are some tips you guys can utilize for growing your chest. Utilize refeed days, make sure your form's good, and incorporating your FST7 training principles to maximize your pump.
Okay, thank you for the first question. And the second question I got a lot also is how do you keep your waist so like tiny? Yeah. So when you're posing, it's like you have any like secret tips you want to share?
You guys, honestly, the waist, a lot of it is genetics. A lot of people are blessed with smaller waists and some aren't. There are exercise. I mean, there are ways to keep your waist down, but there's only so much that you're going to be able to battle against genetics. If you're doing a lot of core strenuous exercises, a lot of explosive movements and power comes from your core. So if you're doing like heavy deadlifts or heavy squats and you're sitting deep in the hole, a lot of that power generated from the core. And when you're exerting yourself and you're pushing out, developing that power, your core is going to push out and you're going to eventually build those muscles in your obliques and internal stabilizers outwards, creating a thicker midsection.
So you don't squat and deadlift much anymore?
I do squat and I do deadlift. I don't go heavy very often.
Yeah.
When I do train those muscles, I'm definitely wearing a waist belt to make sure that I'm keeping my core as stable as possible, keeping that thing nice and tight, make sure it's pulled in. But I utilize a lot of pre-exhaustion sets before I go into squats and deadlifts. I'm a bodybuilder. I'm not a power lifter. I'm not trying to lift as much weight as possible.
Yeah.
That's not necessarily the best way of growing. I'm training for hypertrophy, so I don't need to squat 400 pounds to get growth. I can pre-exhaust my legs with leg extensions and get the pump, and then go into a lighter squat with less weight and still maximize my growth by optimizing blood flow. I don't need to lift as heavy. So before doing our squats, I like to do leg extensions or use an FST7 training principles for like leg extensions, and then jump into more FST7 training principles with squats. You know, go lighter weights, do some partial reps, partial to full reps, maybe a rest pause set.
Yeah.
You know, those are variables you can do to increase your intensity when you're training and not have to use as much weight.
All right, cool. Okay, thank you for the second question. And the third question.
Let me finish that one.
One
of the most important things is also how you train your midsection. You aren't going to want to do a bunch of ab exercises with a lot of weight. You know, I don't do hardly any weighted ab exercises. A lot of it is your breathing technique. And when you train your abs before you contract, blow all your air as much as you can. Like if you're up top and you exhale your air, as hard as you can, your obliques will come in when you exhale your air, and then you contract. That way you're going to be training your waistline and when you're contracting. It's also going to teach you how to breathe on stage as well.
All right. That's a very good tip from Mr. Jeremy. And the last question, as you guys know, in Thailand now, the men's physique society is growing like crazy. Our last Mr. Thailand lineup for men's physique is over 200 athletes. Over 200. So the question I got a lot is like, what's the judge really looking for? I mean, the IFBB, what they're really looking for? Why the biggest guy is not the winner, and what they're really looking for?
First off, the biggest guy is not the winner. It's about overall look and overall presentation and flow of the physique. You know, it's from the top to the bottom of who has the most beneficial or the most ideal package. So understanding that size necessarily isn't going to win, but having nice lines and have nice symmetry is what's going to stand out. A small waistline, well-developed lats, well-developed chest. It's whoever has the least amount of weaknesses in their physique that's going to win on stage. And you also got to understand it's going to be based off of the competition itself. You know, what type of guys show up to that lineup? If it's a bigger competition and more muscular guys are in a competition, they're going to lean to a more muscular guy winning, opposed to maybe a taller lineup with skinnier guys. They're going to go with that lineup. And it just depends on the kind of median of what the competitors are looking like.
Yeah.
You know, at Olympia, for example, you know, there weren't any guys over 5'10" in the first callouts because I've been winning the last 3 years. So they're putting guys with similar physiques next to me to compete against my physique. You know, when early on in men's physique, the first couple of years, it was kind of all over the place. You had Steve Cook, who's 6'2". You had Sadiq, who's about 6', Poston, who's 5'11". And then you have me, that's like 5'7". It was kind of all over the place.
Yeah.
And then now, you know, that I've been winning the last few years, they're leaning toward more of my physique standards. I'm not the biggest guy on stage. I have one of the smallest waists. I have a full chest, a well-developed muscle bellies. I think I have the most complete physique on stage. You can't really pick apart very much when it comes to my physique, and that's what they're looking for as far as, you know, being a well-rounded men's physique competitor. It's the bigger guys aren't winning because it's about flow of the physique. If you're too big, then you can go up a division. If you're too small, then you're not gonna be able to hang. So it's just finding the right balance to your physique.
Cool. That's so, Mr. Brondia, he set up the standard for the men's physique competition, right? So if you guys wanna competing or anything, please look up to him. And so thank you so much.
Hey, thanks for training me today.
Thank you, man. Thank you.